Welcome to the 11th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. With no apologies today, we're joined by Fulton McGregor virtually. The first item on the agenda is to agree whether to take item 3 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Are we all agreed? Okay, that is agreed, thank you. Next item is to take evidence from our panel on women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. And I'm pleased to welcome Ruth Boyle, Policy and Parliamentary Manager of Close the Gap, who is joining us remotely. Ailey Dixon, Policy and Parliamentary Manager in Gender, and Professor Noreen Arshad, Chair in Entrepreneurship and Innovation at the School of Business at the University of Dundee. You're all very welcome. I'll now invite you all to make some short opening statements, starting with Ailey Dixon, please.
Convener. Thank you also to the committee for organising this session and for inviting me to be part of it. Looking back to early spring 2020, Engender quickly realised and foresaw the impact that the pandemic was likely to have for women. When we started looking at the research of the experience of the previous outbreaks of SARS, Zika and Ebola, we published our first briefing summarising the key issues that we could foresee happening in Scotland back in 26th of March 2021, which included a lack of attention to gender mainstreaming, the exclusion of women from decision making, increased care and reproductive labour, increased violence against women and greater exposure to poverty and insecurity. Our concerns at that time have only proven to be right. In the subsequent impacts of the pandemic, it's often said that the pandemic has exacerbated deeply rooted inequalities experienced by women, racialised communities, disabled people and other groups. And I often cite UN Women's statistics that warrant UN Women's warning that pandemic risks setting back global strides towards equality by 25 years. The lack of prioritisation of care in the response to the pandemic is itself gendered. The underlying assumption that was necessary for schools and other institutions to be closed was that the displaced childcare, homeschooling and care for older adults and disabled people would and could be picked up in the home. Women's access to paid work, leisure time and power remains heavily constrained by traditional social roles as carers and mothers, even as they've increasingly entered and remained in the labour market over the last few decades. On average, even before COVID, women in Scotland living in opposite sex headed households did around 68% of the housework and 68% of the childcare. And these patterns of the distribution have been stubbornly slow to disrupt and have only been cemented even further by the pandemic. And in June 2020, Engender published a short report on women and unpaid work, where we found that despite popular descriptions of a crashing productivity crisis in the real economy, women were in fact busier than they had ever been. These findings were then reinforced by data from a joint survey project looking at these impacts of COVID-19 that was developed by Engender, Close the Gap and other UK women's organisations and carried out between December 2020 and July 2021. We also saw that these themes were repeated in the many stories that were shared within Engender through our online platform, Women COVID Scot. One woman told us, "My employer is offering flexibility, but there just aren't enough hours in the day for both me and my partner to do all of the work we have to do and make sure our wee people are taken care of. I'm worried about my mental health, but mostly about my children. My partner earns a lot more than me and I'm seriously considering resigning." We heard this over and over and over again, as I'm sure many of us in the room here today have done. And I'm therefore extremely pleased that the committee is today focusing on unpaid work delivered by women and the impacts of that now and in the longer term. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Professor Arshad.
Thank you, everyone, for inviting me to this committee. Thank you. So let me just give you a background on the impact of COVID on Scotland's women entrepreneurs. The aim of the report was to provide an in-depth understanding of the impact COVID-19 on women entrepreneurs in Scotland had and to explore the support that was available to them during and after the pandemic. The research for this project was undertaken between October 2020 and March 2021. This is a qualitative study and was based on 12 focus groups with women entrepreneurs, 6 with startups and 6 with growth businesses in 6 different regions in Scotland. And there was 12 individual interviews carried out on a monthly basis for 4 months with 12 women entrepreneurs to build a better picture rather than a snapshot of time of what the challenges they were facing at that time. And also I undertook 26 enterprise support organisation interviews and 11 of those enterprise support organisations were focused on women-only support. The findings of the report highlight the challenges women entrepreneurs faced amplified during the pandemic. The main challenges focused around historically reported barriers for women entrepreneurs. These are firstly the access to finance. Many sectors dominated by women were first to be hit the hardest and the last to receive financial assistance. Networking, where understanding how women entrepreneurs could ensure their businesses were promoted. And lastly, social and cultural barriers and challenges. And this is where it included, for example, childcare, domestic, unpaid domestic work, working from home and community care. However, there was opportunities arose for many in learning new skills, exploiting digitisation and in continuing the relationship with their communities and spending more time with their children. With respect to the enterprise support organisations, they were quick to attempt to support women entrepreneurs, but much of the support, in particular financing and funding element and childcare responsibilities, was found to be confusing by women entrepreneurs, and these organisations did not consider the heterogeneity of women and their needs. Policy actions arising from the evidence gathered in this research include access to quicker funding routes by investing in creating a one-stop shop for financial support and assistance, facilitating access to Kickstarter and or seed funding for women entrepreneurs, creating new approaches to sourcing capital investment such as crowdfunding and impact investment, creating digital centres based in local infrastructure such as libraries, universities, colleges and community centres where it's easily accessible for women, creating and coaching mentoring champions in all Scottish regions for women entrepreneurs, expanding and lowering the cost of childcare. This can include higher investment in after-school care in early years, offering childcare options within the social infrastructure. And these policy actions can be met by simplifying the women's entrepreneurial ecosystem, producing a toolkit to help women navigate the support and advice available to them, long-term evaluation and gender disaggregated data, establishing regional women's business centre hubs and collaborating with financial institutions to provide available, accessible and appropriate finance for women entrepreneurs. On a final note, we do welcome and we do understand Scotland has a long-standing policy framework for women's enterprise, but these challenges are still being amplified and have never been any less over the last 15, 20 years. More recently, Scottish Government have been working towards remedying the current women's entrepreneurial ecosystem, with the First Minister announcing and pledging £50 million for funding for a women's business centre. We welcome the commitment and the programme for government to progress a women's business centre, but currently there is little, if any, information as to what the business centre will look like and what facilities and functions it will provide for women entrepreneurs. So this might be an area that we could discuss further. Again, thank you for having me here.
Thank you. And Ruth Boyle. I think you're on, Ruth.
Oh, sorry, my microphone hadn't come on yet. Thank you, convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting Close the Gap to give evidence today. We're really pleased to be here. And thanks to the clerks as well for accommodating me remotely. Close the Gap is Scotland's policy advocacy organisation working on women's labour market equality. And we have 20 years experience of working with employers, trade unions and policymakers to encourage substantive action on the causes of the gender pay gap. Our analysis shows that women's increased likelihood of having primary responsibility for childcare, care and unpaid domestic work remains a key cause of the gender pay gap in Scotland. The lack of flexibility offered in the Scottish labour market, coupled with continued barriers to accessible, affordable and flexible childcare, creates something of a perfect storm for women who are trying to balance paid and unpaid work. And this, of course, creates challenges for women with caring responsibilities in entering the labour market, but it also prevents women's in-work progression, limiting their opportunities to enter senior roles or to increase their hours or their earnings. As a result of having to balance earning with caring, we see that women account for 75% of part-time workers in Scotland. And this is significant because most part-time work is found in the lowest paid jobs and sectors of the Scottish economy. So this reinforces women's low pay and makes it difficult for women to find work that matches their skill level. COVID-19 has brought these issues into sharp focus as it's fallen to women to manage increasing levels of unpaid work. Over the pandemic, Close the Gap has published briefings and analysis on the impact of the crisis on women's labour market equality. And this work has highlighted that the crisis has created huge challenges for women in maintaining paid work, with many women having to reduce their hours or leave work entirely in order to care. Just to close, we really welcome the committee's focus on this topic. It's really positive to see attention being afforded to unpaid care, which is often a peripheral policy issue. Tackling the issues that we discussed today is vital to unlocking women's labour market equality, tackling the gender pay gap, as well as meeting Scotland's child poverty targets.
Okay, thank you all very much for your opening remarks. We're now going to move into question and answer session. Ruth, particularly, if you're wanting to respond to a question, if you could put R in the members might direct things directly to members, but if they don't and you want to respond to something, if Ruth could put R in, and obviously Fulton will know how to make sure that I'm aware that he's wanting to come in as well. The guys in the room, if you just indicate that you're wanting to respond, I'll keep my eyes open. So first question then, over to Maggie.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for being with us this morning and for your opening remarks. I'm interested in understanding a little bit about the difference across different age groups of women. And we know, and you've all alluded to the sort of amplification of existing inequalities that the pandemic had. But we know that the pandemic was maybe particularly acutely felt by younger women, those in the 18 to 30 age group, who experience financial precarity anyway. Can you give us a little bit more detail around that, and also how it compares to older women? Are there areas that we should be considering to look at for sort of much older women, but still sort of working age? And how does it change? How does the impact change across women's lives, I suppose? Thank you. Ailey,
thank you. So there's a couple of things I can say on this. I mentioned in my opening remarks that Close the Gap and Engender had undertaken some polling, which was specifically looking at Scotland, or there was a UK project, but we specifically looked at Scotland, and some of that focused on young women. So just to give you a bit of a snapshot, the survey showed us that young women were reporting even greater vulnerability to economic precarity, and that's not surprising because we know that younger women and black minority ethnic women are more likely to be concentrated, as both Noreen and Ruth said, in the sectors that were first affected and were most greatly affected by the results of the pandemic. 53% of young men had their furlough salary topped up by their employer, compared to just 35% of young women. For BME young women, that was just 27%. Younger women were 7 percentage points more likely than their male counterparts to say that their financial situation had worsened since the start of the pandemic. That was 41% of the young women that we spoke to. And disabled young women were 20 percentage points more likely to say that non-disabled young women were to say that their financial situation had worsened as a direct result of the pandemic. We also know, and Ruth can maybe say more on this directly, but we know that the gender pay gap exists at every age, but we know that it widens sharply when women reach 30, and it continues to widen sharply. And the lack of available childcare will almost certainly be playing a role in that. I mean, it certainly will be playing a role in that. I think Ruth can maybe say more on the interrelation of those two things. And we also, just the last point I would make is that young women's mental health has been of particular concern. I talked about the Women COVID Scot project that we ran, where we asked women to submit anonymously, either publicly or directly to us, their own stories of the pandemic. And over again, what came through was this crushing sense of mounting pressure, that they were expected to do more with the same amount of time. They were expected to do homeschooling for children in multiple different year groups. There was more domestic work because the whole family was at home. And although their partners, if they had a male partner, their partner was doing more, they were still doing more. So that sense of pressure is not surprising. But the polling that we did also showed that 62% of young women said that their mental health had worsened since the outbreak, compared to 55% of young men. So I think we're really looking at a bit of a crisis point. The existing mental health strategy that's due to run until 2020 27 was clearly developed in a pre-pandemic world, and I think there are genuine questions to be asked about whether that document is fit for purpose. A transition plan does exist that does take a bit more of a gendered focus, but the lack of focus that we've seen on gendered differences in mental health presentation and experiences is a chronic problem that's pervasive through mental health policy.
Thanks very much for that, Ailey. Ruth, do you want to come in on that too, and then Noreen?
Yes, thank you. I was going to pick up on the polling that we had done, so that's very useful that Ailey has already given that context. When we look at young women's experience of employment during the pandemic, we see that young women were more likely to be furloughed than their male counterparts, and they were also more likely to work in a shutdown sector. And when we've been talking about women being more adversely affected by job disruption, this is because it's based upon women's pre-existing inequalities in the labour market. When we look at young women's employment, we see that they're concentrated in low-paid, precarious sectors. So predominantly these service sectors like retail and hospitality that were shut down during the pandemic. And because of this, we know that young women were already more likely to be experiencing in-work poverty and were therefore less likely to have savings to fall back on during the pandemic. So if you look at retail, for example, we see that 4 in 10 of those working in retail are paid less than the real living wage, and 80% of those working in hospitality reported that they were already struggling with their finances pre-COVID. So we see an exacerbation of pre-existing financial precarity for young women. As Ailey said, we also saw that young women were less likely to have their furloughed salary topped up by their employer. I think as well there's pre-existing issues for young women in terms of accessing training and development in the labour market. And that's often because in the sectors that they're dominant, training and development isn't often a focus. So a recent report by the Young Women's Movement, the Status of the Young Women Report, found that only 44% of young women felt supported by their employer to develop skills at work. And this is particularly pertinent for young women with caring responsibilities, who are particularly concentrated in low-paid jobs and sectors. This is obviously significant for Scotland's child poverty targets because young mothers are a target group within that plan. The polling that Ailey mentioned also found that 1 in 10 young women reported that their caring responsibilities were a key barrier to them accessing training and development or employment support. By contrast, no young men who were polled as part of that project highlighted caring responsibilities as a barrier to employment or to training. I think as well, just to pick up on the mental health issues that Ailey raised, we know that women's experience of mental health is fundamentally linked to gendered inequalities regarding care and income inequalities. And as the pandemic has worsened these factors, it's clear why there is a growing mental health crisis among women and young women in particular. We also know that women are effectively poverty managers in the home. So they often go without clothing or warmth or food themselves in order to provide for their children. And we know that during the pandemic, when women were reporting that they were struggling to make ends meet, if they were having to do this gender dynamic of poverty management in the home, that could have increased their problems with mental health and wider mental well-being. So we do see issues there in terms of an exacerbation of women's pre-existing inequality in the labour market. As Ailey said, this is not to say that there are not issues for older women in the labour market. And indeed, I'm just doing our latest gender pay gap analysis paper. And when we look at that, we do see a gender pay gap for all age groups, but it's a higher than average gender pay gap for an over 40s woman. And this is where you see the motherhood penalty playing out in terms of pay data and in terms of the gender pay gap. So women undertaking the bulk of unpaid care, perhaps reducing their working hours or leaving work entirely to care for a period of time, that has lifetime implications for their pay rates. And also, while there's been a lot of focus on young women's employment, and rightly so, when we look at furlough data, towards the end of the scheme, it was actually older women who were more likely to still be furloughed. But I do think there's a little bit of work that needs to be done to understand the impact of the pandemic on older women's employment, because we also know that there are real barriers to older women in accessing employment and also accessing training and development.
Thanks very much for that, Ruth. That's really helpful. Noreen, can I ask you as well, picking up on some of the points that have been made, I was going to say, what do we do about it? But which, you know, the million-dollar question. How? What are the key steps that we need to be taking as a parliament, as a government, to ensure that this financial precarity isn't exacerbated as we move forward?
I mean, I completely agree with Ruth and Ailey's comments. But given the perspective from a woman's entrepreneurship background and the studies I've undertaken in women entrepreneurs, pre-COVID, post-COVID, blah, blah, blah. The age doesn't seem to matter because they're all in the same boat in terms of dominantly are in the service sector, dominantly could not access or find their way around finance, dominantly had childcare responsibilities, dominantly had the unpaid domestic work to deal with. Now, I had 70 plus women in my focus groups. Three quarters of those women had children. Only one partner helped with those responsibilities. Now, that's just a snapshot of a small sample, but it's very applicable to Scotland, to the UK. Given that, I think some of the things that, you know, Scottish Government or MSPs or our organisations that can do it is, you know, we need to understand long-term evaluation. We need gender disaggregated data. So how is it, what's happening on the ground? Is it effective? What's impacts being made socially and economically? We need to collaborate with financial institutions to understand access to financial support. What's the easiest route? What's appropriate? Because, you know, women aren't just one group. Regardless, they have different roles. And very often, we touched on very lightly, is that, okay, they have domestic unpaid work, they have businesses or they're working, but a lot of them seem to do a lot of community work too. So that's, you know, they've got very, so how do we work around and assist and support them in their different roles and ensure it's holistic rather than, you know, we're only helping women entrepreneurs here, we're only helping women here. So, you know, that's a question I'm bouncing back to you. You have the resources, you have the power. So, you know, this is how do we approach this in a holistic manner?
Thank you, that's helpful. I'll leave it there for now.
Pam Gossel.
Good morning and thank you very much for coming along. It's been very useful, obviously, hearing open statements in relation to how women have suffered over the pandemic. And it's something that obviously it's at the heart of this committee. That's why we decided to work on this. My question is around, I've got one for you later on, Noreen, but just around question on evidence that it's showing that women, disabled women, BME and lone parents have disproportionately affected by the pandemic. Should these groups have received or receive focused support to ensure that full access to employment as we embark out our socioeconomic recovery from the pandemic? And if so, what kind of policies do you think that we should be looking at in Parliament? I think this could be to Ruth and Aidan, and then I'll come back to Noreen for her question. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a really important question. And I mentioned that Close the Gap have done a lot of analysis of the labour market impacts of the pandemic, looking at the specific impacts on women's employment. And throughout that work, we've tried very hard to take an intersectional approach. So looking at the impacts on specific groups of women. I would note that we've been hindered in doing that by a lack of intersectional labour market data. This is something that we talk about a lot. But we're actually very far from having consistent gendered labour market data. That means we're very, very far away from having consistent intersectional labour market data. So, for example, if we think about Black minority ethnic women or disabled women, we were unable to access data relating to furlough, unemployment, occupational segregation or pay. And that makes it very difficult to demonstrate the differences that particular groups of women have experienced in the labour market. So in terms of an early policy priority, it should be the gathering of gender disaggregated intersectional data as standard across all policy responses, in particular labour market data and skills programmes data as well. That's really important. What we can do is to predict the impact on different groups of women based upon the data that we do have. So if we look at Black and minority ethnic women, we expect that job disruption has been particularly acute for Black and minority ethnic women because of them being concentrated in low paid precarious sectors. So again, these are sectors that were more likely to be shut down during the pandemic. We also saw in the polling data that Ailey has mentioned already that 21% of Black and minority ethnic women responding to that polling said that they felt they were unfairly chosen for furlough by their employer, compared to only 1% of white women. Equally, 19% of disabled women felt they were unfairly chosen for furlough, compared to only 1% of non-disabled women. We do have questions there in terms of some of the discrimination that's perhaps come through. We're concerned in terms of Black and minority ethnic women that the pandemic can exacerbate pre-existing inequality in the labour market. So Black and minority ethnic women were already more likely to be in work poverty, are concentrated in precarious work, and also had barriers to progression. Close the Gap published research in 2019 called Still Not Visible that looked at the experience of Black and minority ethnic women in employment in Scotland. And that research found high levels of racism, racial discrimination, prejudice, and bias in the Scottish labour market. Some of the issues that we're talking about today in particular, 49% of women who responded to that survey felt that they had been overlooked for a training or development opportunity because of racism, prejudice or bias. 42% felt that they had been discriminated against at interview stage. There could be issues for Black and minority ethnic women who have perhaps lost their job during the pandemic and trying to enter the labour market again. What that research also highlighted was that Black and minority ethnic women experience the barriers that all women experience around caring responsibilities in the labour market, but this was somewhat intensified for Black and minority ethnic women, who also reported barriers in accessing appropriate childcare for their children. Migrant Black and minority ethnic women responding to that survey also highlighted that a lack of access to informal networks made it very difficult for them to enter the labour market. This is because that increased their reliance on formal, expensive childcare, which made it very difficult for them to find work that actually made it financially viable. And they also reported a lack of understanding on behalf of their employers that they didn't have people to rely on. So, for example, if their child was sick, that meant they had to work from home or to have that day off in order to care for children. So we do see particular barriers for Black and minority ethnic women that could be intensified by the pandemic. There's a real lack of data on disabled women in the labour market, and Close the Gap are at the planning stage for some research on disabled women's experiences of employment in Scotland in an attempt to try and find some data that could plug some of those gaps. We do know that flexible working and remote working is particularly important for disabled women. So this is likely to have had a positive impact on disabled women's experience of employment in Scotland. However, I'm hoping we might have time to talk about flexible working in more detail later, but we're concerned that that increase in flexibility might not be maintained in the aftermath of the pandemic. As Ailey highlighted in the polling data, we know that the financial impacts of the pandemic has been particularly acute for disabled women, with disabled women being more likely to report struggling to make ends meet, greater rates of anxiety and stress. And finally, just to touch on lone parents. Lone parents are trapped in poverty by a range of factors, including a lack of flexible and part-time working, lack of affordable childcare, and a lack of access to appropriate training and development. We know that the issues that all women have experienced in the pandemic have been particularly acute for lone parents who maybe haven't been able to rely on informal networks or family members to assist with childcare. Over 90% of lone parents in Scotland are women, so this is a gendered issue when we're talking about the experiences of lone parents. And it's likely that lone parents have in particularly had to leave work in order to care or to reduce their hours, which has impacts for their financial security. And again, that's significant because that's a priority group within the Child Poverty Delivery Plan.
Thank you, Ruth. I've just got a question for Noreen. Is that okay? Yeah. Good morning, Noreen. My question is around, it's interesting, you talked about your survey from October 2020 to March 2021, and you talked about the three areas, obviously one being access to finance, networking, and then the cultural barriers. Just on those three, looking at, obviously, you did a snapshot survey then. Have you done anything before that to say that has it got worse through COVID, or is this something that was already there and these inequalities, like Ailsie mentioned earlier on, that it's just come out? So it's just to say that, is there a comparison?
Thank you. So the survey, it was qualitative, so it was focus groups and interviews, and I was previously... Jamie Hepburn, who is Minister for Business, Fair Work and Skills, has an independent advisor for a year just before lockdown happened. And funnily enough, I had just published a report on this. There was no pandemic then. And the three challenges were highlighted there. And I did, again, all of Scotland, over 100 women. We did 20 case studies. So it was similar to this, in depth, took a year. And that got held back. It's been released now, but the publication was due in April 2020. Obviously, everything got locked down. They thought, oh my God, everything's going to change. Halt the report, let's see how things pan out. And then this study was undertaken as a Scottish Parliament fellow. So I thought, okay, so what's happened since? Funnily enough, these three challenges still exist. They've existed for the past 20 years. The only thing is they've amplified during the pandemic. So the access to finance, networking, the social cultural barriers have been a global... these have been global challenges for women entrepreneurs. No government has managed to address them. No government has managed to halt them. No government has managed to fix them. These have been amplified, and again, we see, as many other studies and women in many other cultures and societies and labour markets, they've been hit the hardest. So these challenges have just been amplified.
Thank you, Noreen. Just quickly on this, an addition that I'd asked, obviously, Ruth as well, that what policies or practices do you think the government should have in place if this is something that was going on before the pandemic? Now it's come out even more during the pandemic. What's the way forward in this? That what kind of policies do you think?
Specifically for women entrepreneurs, one, they need access to finance in terms of an easier route. And understanding that actually women aren't looking for £1 million. Often they're looking for small pots of fund to tide them over. And one of the key things related to this committee's, this morning's committee meeting is that expanding and lowering the cost of childcare is a must. And this can include higher investment in early childcare, after school childcare in early years, but also embedding childcare options within the social and economic infrastructure. We don't have that. And the expense of it, it's impossible. Whereas women have had to give up their businesses to homeschool, to look after their children, to help in the community, elderly parents. But also long-term evaluations are needed. What's working? What's not working? There's so much happening. I mean, going back to the women's enterprise entrepreneurial ecosystem, there's so much happening out there. It's unbelievable, but there's duplication. We don't know if it's effective. We don't know who's doing what. We don't know what women are coming where. And we need to align this. And this would work with different sectors, not just in the business world, but also in the labour market, to simplify, to understand what's happening for women out there and what's effective. Because at the moment, we don't know. And again, it goes back to the three main challenges. Now, if we knew what was happening on the ground and how effective it was, surely we'd address that. So why are these three challenges still happening?
No, thank you, Noreen.
Alexander, thank you. Do you want to come in quickly, then Ailey's going to come in?
Just a quick supplementary. You talked about initially, Professor Noreen, when you spoke about the Business Women's Centre, yes, and the funding that's been put together. So what kind of game changer do you think that is going to be, if it is a game changer, or is it just going to progress to then assess and look at where we are, what is required, but there will still be a gap, even having that centre and the resource that comes behind it?
Okay. At the moment, we know what women need, and how this can be addressed. It's £50 million over 5 years, I think the first minister announced. Now, I've tried to chase up several people, and I, you know, obviously it's a new initiative, it's very early, but I don't know, and I can't really answer that because I don't know what this centre will look like, where it'll be based. Is it digital? Is it bricks and mortar? What facilities, what functions? Because we know the challenges, we know how they can be addressed. Now, the 50 million for the women's business centres, how will those challenges be addressed? What will it look like? And that's my key question back to you.
And we need to find out. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen.
Thank you. I was going to ask questions really around mental health, and I feel like you have answered some of those questions. So I'd like to maybe shift that focus a bit here. We've heard about women often going without food and clothing to prioritise others' needs. So I'd like to ask, in the context of something which is often deprioritised, and that is women's health, women tend to have more physical disruptions, for want of a better word, such as menstrual-related health issues, pregnancy and birth, postpartum care and menopause, which in itself has multiple layers of health issues. And all of these can impact day-to-day living without appropriate care. For example, heart disease in women is a silent killer, as it's often overlooked or dismissed. Job access, equality and working out of the home often depends on being physically able. Where does women's physical health come into this? Was this also deprioritised or overlooked? And did you see within your remits any effects of women's health inequalities which perhaps became more apparent during the height of the pandemic? Is this a noted factor in gender-based inequality?
Do you want to kick off?
Thank you very much for that question. So in terms of health, the polling that Ruth and I keep mentioning did look at physical health and activity levels, and across the board found that women were doing less physical activity and had lower access, or had their nutrition had been deprioritized. So for example, 42% of young women believed that their physical health had worsened since the start of the pandemic, compared to 30% of young men. Nearly half of disabled young women reported that their physical health had deteriorated, compared to 38% of non-disabled young women. So we know that was a key theme. I think it would have been really interesting to look back at the first lockdown, when we all had 1 hour a day that we could go out, how women used that hour. And I've said this over and over again in different contexts, because in that hour, many women, if they didn't have gardens, had to take their children out to play, but the playgrounds were closed. Many women were trying to do paid work, so they couldn't go for a run at night when it was dark because they didn't feel safe in the streets. So how did women prioritise their access to physical activity? There was time use data published by the Scottish Government, and it did show that women tend to spend a bit more time on, or over 2020 during the pandemic, obviously, women tended to spend a bit more time than men on social leisure activities. So the examples they use were letter writing, emails, but I suspect we all think, you know, they were on Zoom and they were checking in on people and that sort of thing. But men had considerably more access to leisure time, more time out the house, more time on the internet, more time relaxing. And that is a pattern that we've seen over and over and over again. And I think we've all kind of skated around the issue of childcare, and it's been so significantly impactful. The deprioritisation of childcare within the initial stages of the pandemic, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the assumption was that there was somebody there to do that care when we had to close the schools. And I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't have closed schools by any measure, but it just didn't appear in any of the pandemic planning. And we just saw a complete lack of gender mainstreaming. And I think that's true across the board. And when it comes to health, obviously we all know the considerable pressure that health services have been under. But looking at, again, some of the stories, some of the reporting, some of the anecdotal evidence we've seen, it was restrictions on maternity services, where women were finding out, you know, terrible things, that they'd lost their baby, or that they were going to have a difficult delivery and they couldn't have a birthing partner with them. And it was just that lack of focus and attention that has cemented so many of the pre-existing inequalities that will have unfortunately led to worse outcomes in women's health. And I think that's something that really needs to be prioritised in both the independent inquiry that's forthcoming, and we've been advocating that there should be an explicit equality and gender equality specifically, because if gender is not mentioned, it doesn't get looked at in the terms of reference that the Scottish Government will set for that inquiry. But obviously then it will be independent and it will be up to them how they look at that. But I think health is one of those things that they really need to be paying attention to.
Karen?
Yeah,
sorry, I think Ruth's wanting to come in, sorry.
Yeah. So, yeah, we don't do a great deal of work on women's physical health, although, of course, it does impact women's access to the labour market. We have seen increased focus in recent months and over the last year, perhaps, of menopause as a workplace issue. This is something that we will be looking at. There's an inquiry at the minute in Westminster on that issue, and I'm sure that's something that Close the Gap will be picking up in due course. One thing I did want to highlight that is impacting women's access to the labour market in terms of health is women's experience of long COVID. So we see that women are more likely to be experiencing long COVID, and as a result, inadequate employer responses to long COVID is making it difficult for women to maintain paid work. And in this way, long COVID has become another means by which women's inequality is being exacerbated by the pandemic. A recent TUC survey found that over half of respondents said that they had experienced some form of discrimination or disadvantage due to long COVID. And over 20 respondents, 1 in 20 responses said that they had been forced out of their jobs because of long COVID. We also know that women are less likely to be in jobs that give them access to statutory sick pay. So women hold around 70% of jobs that are not entitled to statutory sick pay. So again, this could be another way in which women's financial precarity is increased. We also know that the current system of employment injuries assistance doesn't meet women's needs. Therefore, if women have injuries that they have acquired in the workplace, they're less likely to be able to access the support that they need. We have responded to the consultation on Mark Griffin's proposed Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill. And I think this is a new thing that we should be thinking about in terms of how women's physical health is impacting their ability to maintain their work, and also how they're able to gain support if they have acquired an injury or health issue within the workplace. If I had time, I just also wanted to briefly say on the last question that I realised that I did not actually highlight any policy responses, despite that being a core part of the question. So I just wanted to highlight that for us, some of the key areas that we need change is around gender-sensitive employability support, gender-sensitive skills and training support. We need to further extend the funded childcare entitlement. We've called for an extension to 50 hours a week, ensuring that we have high quality social care that enables women to enter the labour market, and also the designation of care as a key growth sector to grow these sectors and also to revalue women's work within these sectors. We also need to increase access to quality flexible working and part-time work, and reassess our policies around shared parental leave. I think those are some of the key priorities in terms of allowing women with caring responsibilities to re-enter the labour market or to maintain paid work.
Okay, thanks for that. I know that Fulton McGregor is wanting to come in on shared parenting later, but Alexander, did you want to come in just now?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you for your evidence so far. Can I talk about, you've talked about the difficulties at home, that home might not be the most safest place to be because of the multiple pressures that were taking place, the financial instability, and also the more domestic work that was taking place. And we have seen, there's no doubt, once again, an increase in violence against women during that time. And that creates the perfect storm for someone who is trapped in that environment and not able to access and get the support mechanisms that they need. So what lessons do we need to look at, and what does that tell us about the support mechanisms that we need to put in place? Because abandoning people to that situation and circumstances, there was also the need for agencies to be involved, and some of them took longer because they had other priorities, other commitments to deal with, and we understand that. But it put individuals in a very precarious situation and continued for them for that duration. And as I say, that in itself created even more difficulties, and there will be consequences, as we already know from that whole process. So it'd be good to get a flavour from you all on how that, maybe Ailey to start with, because you spoke about it primarily in your update.
Of course, thank you very much. And as you say, I think it's really important, before we start, that to be clear that when we discuss violence against women, coronavirus does not cause violence. It's the measures that have been put in place to manage the public health impacts that have created and exacerbated the circumstances in which women are made more acutely vulnerable and perpetrators' abuse is more easily facilitated. So that would be women being exposed to poverty. You know, if women had to give up work because of childcare and they suddenly found themselves reliant on a partner's income, that facilitates much more easily the access and control over, the control over resources. Universal credit is a state design that does the same thing. So if women found themselves on universal credit, again, access to resources was constrained. And as you mentioned, women find it much more difficult to interact with the normal support services and agencies that they would have done so, or the health services and the education services that might identify risks for women. We're not able to do that. Women's inequality is a cause and a consequence of men's violence. And so we need to think about this in two tracks. There is work that needs to be done to better support the services that women rely on. So that means core funding for women's aid services and men's violence against women services like Rape Crisis Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid. That was done. The Scottish Government did give out more funding, but there still is a big problem with security of funding and long-term funding. And when those services had to redesign themselves, a lot of that scrambling was around access to resources that they could use in order to develop new forms of services. Scottish Women's Aid did a survey of the services in June 2020, and what that showed was only about a quarter of services at that time said there had been no impact or decreased inquiries for support. Most services had seen either a huge increase or fluctuating increase, which in some ways is more complex because, again, you're trying to respond, design a service in a new way, and you don't know what the demand will be. And women there've been pipeline issues with getting women out of their home into refuge accommodation and then into other forms of more permanent accommodation. So I think there are many things that we need to tackle. The financial support is one thing. It's been talked about a lot recently in the 16 days of activism debates, but the impact of the backlog in the justice system is having a significant impact on women who are victims, survivors of abuse and men's violence. So there really needs to be some concrete action to speed up the reopening of court processes. The cultural attitudes is complicated, but vital. And when we did our unpaid work paper, what we found was that attitudes about what roles women should or shouldn't do hadn't changed as much as we would have thought. So in the 1980s, between the 1980s and the 2012, I want to say, but apologies if that's wrong, the number of people who'd said that women would be more predominantly responsible for care had only decreased by 10%. You know, there was still an underlying assumption there that women would take on the majority of childcare and that they would give up work to do that. And that's underpinning everything in this culture. And I think we're at risk at the moment of entering into a vicious cycle where women are becoming further detached from the labour market, further detached from the support systems, further detached from finance that allows them to take advantage of opportunities and to develop their own careers and their own social contributions. And as a result, they do more care, they do more unpaid work, so then they have fewer opportunities. And so we're just in this endless cycle. And I think it's really important that we do look for those policy interventions that will disrupt it. So yes, the 50 hours of wraparound, cultural, flexible childcare that we need to see. Yes, making social care and and childcare key economic infrastructure, investing in those sectors. It's a whole systems approach. If we look at flexible working as the silver bullet, for example, whilst we're in this cycle of women becoming more and more detached from the labour market, it could inadvertently lead to women being able to, being required to take on more care. So we do need to think holistically about all of these things. We do need to think about violence against women. We do think about funding for women's organisations, and we need to think about how the two interact with one another. So that's a very long answer to your question. Everything and nothing.
Thank you. And Ruth, you may have some views as well on this one.
Yes, I would reiterate everything that Ailey has said there, particularly around the funding point and also the nuance that is required around describing this increase in violence against women during the pandemic. I just wanted to touch on some of the workplace implications of this. We know that violence against women affects all aspects of women's lives, and the workplace is no exception. So 3/4 of women who experience domestic abuse are targeted at work. In a recent survey by Close the Gap that was conducted as part of our employer accreditation programme found that 75% of respondents had experienced or witnessed sexual harassment in the workplace over a 12-month period. When we think about the COVID-19 context, as Ailey says, what we see is an intensification of this. So with women who were working from home in unsafe situations, we see that perpetrators may have prevented victim survivors from working from home by denying access to necessary equipment or insisting that women have responsibility for childcare. Within sexual harassment in the workplace, we see that perpetrators had new access to women because of a reliance on online communications. And also women reported that they had increased barriers to reporting sexual harassment during the pandemic, because they didn't believe that this was a priority for their employer during the crisis. And this is concerning because pre-pandemic, we see that 80% of those experiencing sexual harassment in the workplace didn't report because of fear of not being believed, of being blamed or losing their job. As Ailey outlined, violence against women is a cause and consequence of gender inequality, and therefore tackling women's labour market inequality is key to tackling violence against women. And I just wanted to flag that Close the Gap have an employer accreditation programme called Equally Safe at Work, which focuses on this link between gender equality and violence against women. And it really underscores the employer role in tackling violence against women in Scotland. And it highlights that employers can improve their employment practice to address the barriers that women experience at work. And I think in the aftermath of the pandemic, this is a really important opportunity for employers to reassess their employment practice, see how they can better support women and victim survivors of violence against women within the workplace. As Ailey said as well, flexible working is really key for victim survivors of domestic abuse in entering the labour market and staying in employment. While there's been a popular narrative that flexible working is now the workplace norm because of the pandemic, we're unsure if that is the reality. And also, if there has been an increase in flexible working in some cases, it's not predetermined that that increase in flexibility will be maintained in the aftermath of the pandemic. Ultimately, this was a reactive decision on behalf of employers in response to public health restrictions rather than a strategic business decision. So I think we could be complacent around thinking that flexible working has been solved, but in reality, we continue to see real barriers to that.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you all. Thank you very much for joining us. It's really important, I believe, that we get right under the skin of this, because not just of what you've said about the UN's warning around women's equality, but also we're seeing, all of us in our constituencies will be seeing every day the impact that it's having on women. So we really need to get ahead of that, and thanks for helping us do that. My questions are around the impact on unpaid care. I've spoken to a number of unpaid carers over the course of the pandemic and before, but the story is bleak, actually, and can be pretty grim. So I just wondered if you could tell us a little bit about your assessment of the impact of the pandemic on unpaid carers, but also the impact of the pandemic on reduced health and social care services, the impact that's had on women's expectations, on the expectations of others on women to do unpaid care. And are there any particular groups of women, for example, younger women or disabled women, lone parents, who have, in your experience, ended up doing more of this unpaid care as a result of services shutting down, etc.?
Noreen, do you want to go first?
Yeah.
Okay, that was quite a lot of questions. Thank you. I'm like, oh, actually, I wrote them down. I was like, thank you. Okay, so given women entrepreneurs, as I mentioned earlier on, 3/4 of them had children and only one said that she had help from her partner. So that lets you know of the 70 plus that they were doing it themselves. So, for example, I can give you lots of examples. For example, one woman who whose business was earning more than her husband's. Her husband was employed and she's self-employed, but yet they took the decision that she would stop her business and look after the children, even though she earned more, because his job was seemingly more important. Sorry, I'm not being facetious, but you know, this story was occurring over and over again. And I think the assumption is there, as Ailey's mentioned, that women are the carers. And it's not just childcare, it's community care, it's elderly parents' care, it's care and very, you know, lots of different arenas and environments. And going back to that, I think with everything being shut down, it was just a given that women would do it. And particularly with the women, businesswomen I spoke with, and the services not being available, also, you know, going back to health, affecting mental health, you know, having, they've set up a business and it had to close, or they had to put it on the back burner. They didn't have the support they needed from their partner, etc., because maybe they were working. So we did see a lot of that. You know, I keep going back to, you know, how we can resolve this in some sort of manner in terms of embedding childcare throughout the social and economic infrastructure. So it's not just for, you know, those in paid employment. It needs to be for everyone who earns money, whether it's small businesses, growing businesses, paid employment, flexible working, part-time. It needs to be across the board, and I think that's key. And how we can help resolve or take some of the burden off mothers who participate and contribute to the Scottish economy. So I'll stop there because I can go on a rant.
Thank you.
Do I go to Ruth next?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I think the experience of unpaid carers is a really important aspect of the impact of the pandemic. We know that there are now 1.1 million unpaid carers in Scotland, 60% of whom are women. And work by Carers Scotland found that 78% of carers reported that they were having to provide more care than they were pre-pandemic. And if the amount of unpaid caring hours you are having to do is increasing, that obviously creates challenges in maintaining your paid working hours as well. And we know that unpaid carers already had barriers to entering the labour market and maintaining their work in the labour market. And this is obviously going to exacerbate that. We also see that the pre-existing mental health challenges that existed for unpaid carers, with 1 in 4 carers reporting that they had not had a break from caring in 5 years. And we also see that 53% of carers receiving carers allowance reported that they are struggling to make ends meet. So a lot of the issues that we've discussed today around financial precarity, barriers to the labour market, mental health and stress are particularly pertinent for unpaid carers in Scotland. What we see at the start of the pandemic was that care was rapidly redistributed from the state to the individual. And as Ailey said, it was almost automatically presumed that a woman would step in to fill those gaps. What work from the Alliance, Inclusion Scotland and Glasgow Disability Alliance has found was that social care packages were removed in some instances, or the eligibility criteria was tightened, which made it harder for people to access social care. And this means that a lot of that care was displaced onto female family members, which again increased their burden of unpaid care. Again, I know I keep continually bringing up flexible working, but flexible working is really pivotal in allowing unpaid carers to manage their unpaid and paid work. Without an increase in flexible working and high quality part-time work, it's likely that we will be pushing unpaid carers out of the labour market, which will cement their poverty and financial insecurity over the longer term. We've welcomed the increased payments of carers allowance supplement over the pandemic, but there really needs to be a longer term mechanism to guarantee unpaid carers financial security. We also need training for carers who are trying to enter the labour market and considering how employers can better support unpaid carers with managing their paid and unpaid needs.
Okay, thank you. Just before we go to Ailey, I'm going to take Fulton, who's got a similar associated question, just and then we'll come to Ailey. So Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, convener. And I just want to say before I start my question, thanks to colleagues and to all the panel today for allowing and clerks for allowing me to be online. And I suppose the very reason that I'm online is relevant to today's meeting. It allows me to obviously perform childcare functions this morning. But I have to say, based on all the to all the discussions that we've had. It's only even as a dad that's trying to do a lot more. It's only a fraction of what my partner in the room next door does with her three children. And I think we need to be honest about that and reflect on it. And even when one of the panelists, I think it was Ailey, was talking earlier about the when we all had an hour a day. I go back to that time, and I think I'm more or less always took the hour a day for a walk, a run, or a cycle. But my partner didn't always. She didn't. We had two kids at that point. I was both the third came along. So, I think we do as men. We need to reflect on these things as well. So thanks for allowing me to say that and for being remote. In terms of my main questions, my first one, convener, is around key workers who were women during the pandemic. I wonder if the panel can elaborate. I know you've talked a wee bit about it and how you think key workers who were women were affected, particularly if they had childcare responsibilities. I'm thinking, nurses, police officers, Royal Mail workers, whatever one you want to think of, they had to still work. And the childcare stuff was non-existent at that point. So how do you think that these workers were impacted? And I'm happy any order that you choose, convener.
Go to Ailey because she'll want to pick up on some of the points from the previous question as well.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'll start with Mr. McGregor's question. So in terms of key workers, we know that between 70 and 80% of key workers at any time were women, or the women who were in the professions listed in the UK government's list of essential workers were women. We know that we all know that essential workers were in theory able to access childcare throughout the pandemic, but in most cases that was only if their partner was also an essential worker or a key worker. We heard anecdotal stories about women whose partners simply refused to take on the childcare, leaving them in incredibly difficult situations trying to negotiate with their employer. Their partner just simply said, I can't cope with it 24 hours a day, I'm not doing it. We also know that it had a significant impact on women who were essential workers, but who were lone parents. In some cases, there weren't even options for them. The forms would say, is your partner also an essential worker? If they didn't have a partner, what were they meant to do? So anecdotally, we know it was a real issue, and attitudinal issues underpinned all of that. To answer the question about social care, I think Ruth has covered a lot of what I was hoping to say, but I think it's worth stressing again that it's not free labour. It's labour that women are there not getting paid for, but it's not free labour. And in fact, the unpaid carers in the pandemic were estimated to save the UK £530 million a day. So it's money that's coming from somewhere. And if women simply down tools and refuse to do it, the state would have to pay for it. And so we're still quite a long way away from recognising that in some ways. We still think it's magically going to appear out of nowhere that women will be available to take on that unpaid care. But if they're not, what does the state do then? And specifically, I mean, Ruth's already mentioned that the organisations that have done a significant amount of work that demonstrated the impact that changing at last minute or ending social care packages had on households and families who were affected by it. Obviously, it undermined disabled women's access to a dignified social care. They denied them their choice of what they wanted to do with that time, and in many cases may have denied them opportunities to participate in paid work or other forms of participation. But again, it has had that impact on female family members, and the essential fact is that we can't afford to wait for a new national care service whenever that is created, because all those social care workers are affected now, as Ruth said, and many of them have been exposed to the virus. Some of them are affected by long COVID. In many cases, their PPE didn't fit them appropriately because it was designed for male bodies. So we need investment in social care now. It's not something that you can afford to wait. And again, it comes back to that whole package of measures we need to take. We need to be looking at childcare, we need to be looking at social care, we need to be prioritising those as infrastructure, we need to be doing the attitudinal changes. There's been some really positive work that's been done. I'm sorry, I can't remember the countries. I know Uganda was involved, but again, looking at the fact that around the world, men did more childcare than they have ever done before. That's a positive story. It shows that they can do it. The problem is that women were still doing more as well. So as we kind of go back into whatever a normal looks like, whenever that happens, there are opportunities to redistribute that some of that labour internally. So thank you.
Okay, thanks. And I think Ruth would like to come in just now as well. So I feel, you want to quickly come back before we go to Ruth?
Yeah, it was just before we moved on to the other panellists in terms of the questions about key workers, convener. I just wanted to also to pick up on stuff that I heard as a constituency MSP, and maybe it can be integrated in the further answers, because although childcare was available in the early days through the education system, the early days of the lockdown, it wasn't as well taken up. And a lot of people said to me that's because, you know, at that point, quite rightly, you know, we're dealing with a new virus that people were really anxious about, and what key workers, many of whom were women, were actually being told, I felt, was, you know, yeah, you can access this childcare and, you know, put you and your family at further risk because the virus is running rampant. So I do wonder if that could be taken into account as well, because there did even seem to be a gender imbalance in that message. So I just wanted to add that in, as I know Ruth's going to go come on to my question.
And Ruth.
Thank you. Yeah, this is a very important issue, and actually, surprisingly, one that maybe hasn't had as much prominence as you would expect it to have had. We did some analysis that found that 79% of key workers in Scotland were women. And this was mostly women working in low-paid, undervalued sectors like essential retail, social care, childcare, and nursing. And research by the Women's Budget Group at the UK level found that women accounted for 98% of key workers earning poverty wages. And these are jobs that were previously branded unskilled that were now seen as being essential to a successful pandemic response. And I think we have an important opportunity in the aftermath of the pandemic to reassess the undervaluation of women's work within these sectors. What we have seen over the pandemic is a reinforcement of the importance of social care and childcare infrastructure to women's access to the labour market. What the first lockdown also showed is that women have a reliance on informal networks to plug gaps in support. And obviously within that first lockdown, both formal and informal childcare was removed from women. This created real challenges for key workers, but particularly for lone parent key workers, as Ailey outlined. We did see that schools and nurseries opened for care for essential workers' children, but there were some problems with accessibility for some families. So we know that women are reliant on public transport, and often these services were further away from their homes than their normal services, which might have created challenges in actually accessing that care. Eligibility was also determined at the local level. And while I haven't looked at this in detail, I wonder if all of the different types of key worker jobs that women were doing were covered by those eligibility criteria. I think, again, it highlighted the importance of flexibility and childcare in terms of allowing women to maintain their paid work. And also, just to pick up on the PPE question, there were some issues around PPE for women key workers roles, in particular social care, and the Royal College of Nursing raised concerns around nursing staff who were working outside of hospital environments. We also know that there are long-standing issues around PPE being inappropriate for women. So the TUC found that only 29% of women who utilise PPE in their work actually use PPE that has been designed for women. And this meant that in the pandemic, PPE wasn't necessarily keeping women safe in some of these roles. And as you outlined, Mr. McGregor, that meant that it was very difficult for women to make decisions, particularly if they were unpaid carers for disabled people or older people who were perhaps vulnerable to the virus. They had to make a decision as to whether going into a workplace and potentially putting family members or loved ones at risk, what was that worth it in terms of being able to maintain your paid work? So I do think that the key worker experience has brought into sharp focus some of the pre-existing issues that we see for women in the labour market and also the continued undervaluation of some of these jobs and sectors.
Okay, thank you. And just before we finish off, I wonder if we could quickly go around everyone. We're kind of past time, but I'd be keen, obviously part of what we're doing is looking back and what went wrong, but I'd be keen just to hear a quick snappy, here's the really thing that we need to do going forward. You know, what's the positives we can take out of the pandemic? So throwing that in there, Noreen, do you want to go first?
Sorry. One thing that the study did report back was that women are much more resilient than we give them credit for.
Okay.
Yeah, so very quickly, I mean, I think the positives we can take are that, as I mentioned, men are doing more than they ever have done before. So let's focus on getting some of the burden off of women when we finally return back to some of the state support for those for that care work. Also, we saw that there was a huge amount of popular support, more than we'd ever seen, for some of the measures that would make life so much easier for women. So there was support for more pay for carers, unpaid carers, more support for NHS workers pay. So we know that the public actually is starting to value care in a way that they maybe didn't before. And the one thing I think we all have been skirting around that I was hoping to just come back in and say is the impact of isolation. You know, people have been locked in their houses, and for unpaid carers in particular, who are caring for a disabled person who is vulnerable to the virus, that's something that's continuing for them and their families. They are still isolating and removing themselves from a lot of the opportunities, and that's having an impact on their mental health and the stress and the pressure that we talked about. So I think we do need to look again at mental health and how we can look forward, but also the pandemic is still with us and it's still very acute for some members of society.
Okay, thank you. And for this week, Ruth, the last word.
Perfect, thank you. Yes, I think some of the issues that I've raised already in terms of gender-sensitive employment support, gender-sensitive skills and training is really important, and just gender mainstreaming and all policy. I think one of the benefits of the pandemic has been that COVID has demonstrated that many more jobs in the Scottish economy are capable of being done on a flexible basis. So this has challenged the cultural assumption against flexibility that we see in certain jobs and sectors. And I think we need to make sure that employers are understanding the business case for maintaining flexibility in the aftermath of the pandemic. That's things like productivity gains, enhanced employee well-being and morale, being able to recruit from a wider talent pool, closing the skills gaps that you have within your business. And we have seen that there's been an increase in home working, but we have seen that other forms of flexibility have actually declined over the course of the pandemic. And it's hours-based flexibility with a focus on part-time work that's really important for women. So I think we need to take the small glimmer that we've seen around flexible working and try and build on this. So how can the Scottish Government integrate flexible working into fair work criteria, for example? And how can we use the various levers that we have with employers to encourage them to take forward flexible working moving forward? We know that 87% of women want to work more flexibly in the future, and it's really about trying to make sure that we're meeting that demand.
Okay, well, thanks very much. Thanks to you all. We've got another session on this next week when we'll be looking at intersectionality, which you've all raised this week as well. But thanks very much, and we'll now move into private session.
Thank you.
Thank you.